I thought, oh, shoot, I got to go buy a flannel shirt and stop using Aquanet.
I didn't like it. I still don't like it. I never understood about singing about how f***ed up your life is when everybody knows their lives are f***ed up. The next generation was more about, you know, teen angst and, you know, I hate my parents rather than let's go out and have some fun and f***ing chicks. It was more about, you know, teen angst and, you know, I hate my parents rather than let's go out and have some fun and f***ing chicks.
Nothing. Axel, if you're watching this, I want to challenge you to a fight. I'm going to give you the time and I'm going to give you the place. And there's no backing out now, buddy.
Some people lose track of reality.
It's time to put up or shut up. I'm really tired of your mouth. And I think a lot of people are.
Let's go out and have some fun and f***ing chicks.
Let's go out and have some fun and f***ing chicks.
Ooh, let me tell you what I want.
Metal was all about groupies, excess, no political stance whatsoever. Just let's all have a real good time. And then the whole Seattle scene happened.
And we started hearing this drony kind of depressing but very socially relevant kind of music coming out of Seattle. It was a big threat. It was a big threat to the metal kings here.
I think that the turning point from metal ruling the world into grunge ruling the world was the song Smells Like Teen Spirit.
When Nirvana's Nevermind record started to leak out, there was almost this collective shiver going through the metal community. Metal was being blindsided by a shift in culture that was so enormous. I mean, you went from joy and decadence and party and banging your head and powery ballads and girls, girls, girls into this world really sucks.
The next generation was more about, you know, teen angst and, you know, I hate my parents rather than let's go out and have some fun and f***ing chicks.
Nothing killed hair metal. It was grunge marketing that affected us. They started to market anger and depression, and that made it big.
I thought, oh, shoot, I got to go buy a flannel shirt and stop using Aquanet.
I didn't like it. I still don't like it. I never understood about singing about how f***ed up your life is when everybody knows their lives are f***ed up.
Thank you. Good night.
It was one of those really interesting political times.
Read my lips.
In 87, there's the stock market crash. And then in 1990, there's Operation Desert Storm. There's this mood of real anxiety, especially for young people. And in places like Seattle, this was really sort of characteristic of the mood of the music scene.
Everybody was working really crappy day jobs and driving crappy cars and renting, you know, group houses. Really no future in sight.
They had to play music. It wasn't to get a record deal. It wasn't to go on tour. It's what they did, what they were driven to do.
You always have the dream of being a rock guy, but it didn't seem real because you're not living in a town where that's or you see people that happening too much, you know?
The first time I met Nirvana, I don't think they had taken a bath for 3 days, and they were pretty fried out and kind of crusty. But at the time, we had no expectations, you know? We were just making a punk rock record and having the time of our lives.
So when Neo Nevermind comes out September 24th, 1991, it's a sort of a dividing line between the old era and the new.
Nevermind was such an amazing record and such a scene-defining record.
It was incredibly exciting the day that Nevermind knocked Michael Jackson out for number one.
It was seen as extremely symbolic because, you know, Michael Jackson was the king of pop. He was the old guard. If you're black or white. And here comes Nirvana.
I was was on the tour bus with Soundgarden when we got the news, and I think the walls shook on the bus. That was a moment in history.
I would turn and get the audience and the band in the pictures, because the audiences were kind of notorious for going crazy.
It was sort of like Beatlemania. It was like hysteria, and I'd never really seen anything like that before.
Kurt singing is maybe the thing that made them. That's why the Unplugged record is the most sort of chill-inducing. Bill's a friend, Bill's a friend. He does that thing that only a few people have done. Lennon could do it. Like you hear the note, and then you hear like a distorted version of the note at the same time. Mary. And Kurt could do it probably better than anyone. Mary. Ever.
All of a sudden the word grunge, you know, your mom and your grandmother knew what grunge was. It was like anybody who was from Seattle, who was under 30. In my eyes. Alice in Chains and Soundgarden and Pearl Jam.
A couple years later when it blew up for like Nirvana and Pearl Jam, and I wasn't envious of those guys at all, you know, I'm glad. None of us were on the cover of Time magazine being called the spokesman of a generation. Nobody asked for that, you know.
Cobain slipped into a coma last night after taking a large dose of painkillers with champagne.
Drug addiction undermined the ability to go forward. And I see that as the greatest undoing.
Cobain's body was found in a house in Seattle on Friday morning. He was dead of an apparently self-inflicted shotgun blast to the head.
Everyone who was alive then pretty much remembers that day. Would you like to hear my
voice? I can never hear Kurt's voice without thinking about his suicide and what a tragedy it was. Even though I still recognize the brilliance of it when I'm hearing it. Why we're talking about this record 20 years later.
It's been described as a sea change, and it was. It was huge. It was huge.
And I think Kurt Cobain and Nirvana are on that very short list of artists whose work transcends their time.
Soon after the release of Nevermind in the fall of 1991, Nirvana left for a short solo tour of Europe. While they were overseas, the band got word that the album was ripping up the charts and saturating the nation.
We just got reports every once in a while, you know, hey, you guys are on the top 40. You know, we didn't even believe people for a long time, you know. We thought everyone was pulling our legs. It just came home as like the Beatles, you know. It's like Nirvana mania.
No one was prepared for the ride when Nevermind broke. The industry wasn't, the media wasn't, the label wasn't, and the band wasn't.
By January, Nevermind had shattered all expectations, ousting Michael Jackson's Dangerous from the number one slot on the pop charts.
It came on MTV News that Nevermind had knocked out Michael Jackson. We just, like, looked at each other in amazement. I mean, our friends, these guys that we know, knocked off the king of pop. It was great.
They had hit a nerve of American youth culture, and it just smelled like teen spirit everywhere.
Nevermind had single-handedly transformed pop music.
There was just a feeling in the air, you know, there was just like this new thing happening, and we knew that we were a part of it.
It was one of those rare, like, perfect moments in rock and roll where everything was like, it seemed right with the world for a change.
Hair metal and dance pop were out. The anti-rock star revolution had begun.
In the 80s, it was all about glitz and glamour and rock stardom and just moving farther and farther away from reality.
People in their 20s had been ignored for so long, and here was a record that made them feel kind of included in this big club of outcasts. Now, this record that kind of feels like you is really popular.
Nirvana did what no punk band had been able to. They brought alternative music to the mainstream.
Nobody really had any kind of history of succeeding with alternative rock until after Nevermind, so that's like a real demarcation point.
Suddenly it's this sort of mass cultural idea, and it's like, who are these people? Where do they come from?
If REM successfully catered to the pop sensibilities of sensitive college students, Seattle Grunge did something similar for traditional working-class rock, sprucing up the usual cool tunes with a harder edge and lots of punk velocity.
That was probably, actually without a doubt, my favorite time in music in the past 10 years.
Probably the allure of the whole thing was that it seemed like normal, everyday people.
I made music serious again, you know, and, you know, without trying.
It was the flannel, you know. It was the grease in the hair. It was the unkempt style.
It just felt really, really special and important. And you could just feel that stuff was, the music was changing gear.
There's always going to be, you know, a handful of people in every generation that get the credit. But certainly for every person that gets the credit, there's 20 other people that deserve credit too that just don't get the level of recognition. You know, for every ounce of credit that Kurt Cobain got, Mudhoney should have gotten just as much credit.
You know? Soundgarden was a great heavy metal band with also a great singer and a deep singer, and they did some musically very amazing things. But Alice in Chains had a kind of a different darkness and a different kind of an aura to them that, you know, was just really right up my strata.
I love Alice in Chains, my God, Rooster, and it's great music.
Soundgarden, Pearl Jam, who, it's not really one of my favorite bands, but had a really great impact.
Pearl Jam was just a great rock band, great live rock band with a great singer who had a way of connecting with the audience.
I think it was an exciting time, just because you see that there's this whole, there was a stream of music just below the mainstream that was way better than what was going on.
I don't think any of them liked being called grunge, or any more than we liked being called the new wave.
And I just kind of flipped the worm turned.
That was great, because it got rid of all those guys with the hairspray and the leotards.
People weren't sort of going on to MTV to be on MTV. MTV was sort of coming to the music.
Something was about to give.
Something had to give. The dam was going to break.
And it did.
And then Kurt came in like, you know, like a phoenix, you know? Like, he cut them down like wheat before the sickle. Whoosh! You know, you are done. Nirvana, to me, was the most significant thing since the Beatles.
The Nirvana album came out, and everybody went, yes! Rock and roll just needs a good kick in the ass every once in a while. You never know when it's going to come.
Teen Spirit. Yeah, Teen Spirit was like...
That was like...
I was feeling
that. That pulled my heart out of my throat and just whipped me around the room.
The song was incredible, and you knew it was their time, and it just was so obvious to all the alt-rock bands that, you know, Nirvana had arrived and everything was going to blow up.
That was the big one, I think. You know, a whole new style from another place in the United States, a major statement.
Actually, I didn't like the video that much. And I seem to remember Courtney once telling me that Kurt didn't like the video either.
It really affected me in that way, where it just sort of filled me up.
It's not about whether that's a great video, it was the video. Whether everybody looks great or it's a nice concept.
Powerful vision, very honest man behind it. You know, very talented.
News special report on a very sad day. Kurt Cobain, the leader of one of rock's most gifted and promising bands, Nirvana, is dead.
We've had a suicide in our band, you know, so that was when I was like about 18, I experienced that. And I think what it does is just the first reaction is just anger, you know, it's like, and I think that's what a lot of people felt.
This guy was truly, obviously truly depressed in his soul.
I kind of avoided getting too deeply into the details of this because it won't put you in a good mood.
I think a lot of his fans are going to be depressed, and he will be truly missed.
The guy was so talented and had his future wide open. You know, and many people that followed that guy and loved that man was like, man.
I loved him. He was amazing.
I thought the guy was brilliant. You know, it's a loss, and at the same time, it was probably inevitable that he did what he did, but he wrote some great stuff.
So sad, because imagine, I mean, maybe we wouldn't even have half of the music we have right now if he was still around. You know, maybe he would be inspiring people to write great music still.
What else can I add to Kurt Cobain that everybody else hasn't said already? I mean, it was genius and changed the musical landscape forever and the story.
The crowd has some fun and chill.